The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
So the mother, wanting to honor this independent streak in her kindergartner, decided that he could walk to school with one of his neighbors that walked the same path. But being the worrier that she was, she asked a good friend, a neighbor of theirs, who takes a morning stroll with her toddler daughter, to kind of watch after them from a distance. So the neighbor, Miss Goodness, went out and did as the mother asked and reported back. And, you know, the kids who were on their way to school did things that kids these age do. You know, they find twigs on the ground and they pick them up and they break them and they kick the rocks and stuff. But, you know, all pretty normal stuff as they went to school. Well, the friend, Timmy's friend, started to notice that there was this woman who kept following them at the same time every morning from about the same distance apart. And finally got the courage to kind of guess, who, do you notice that this woman is following behind us? Yeah, who is this woman? And Timmy said, "Yeah, well, I know who it is. That's just Shirley Goodness and her daughter, Marcy." And said, "Shirley Goodness? Well, who is Shirley Goodness and why is she following us?" "Well," Timmy said, "I don't know, but every night my mama makes me say the Psalm 23 every time with my prayers, and in that it says, 'Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.' And so I guess I just have to put up with it." And I guess you all are just going to have to put up with the rector who finds humor in such puns and stories. But notice what's here. Notice what's contained kind of in the joke as we laugh about it. Timmy knows his mother, and Timmy knows that he's worried about her. And so Timmy sees that care. He sees the care of the mother, but he sees it kind of in a different way than his mom intended. He doesn't quite get what she was trying to do. He was making a connection through a reading of scripture that, you know, is funny to us, but kind of meant a different thing for him as he was on his way to school. Of course, his mother intended for him to be watched over and make sure everything was safe. And so it got me thinking, as we come to this reading from John's Gospel, as we come to this familiar reading that we've known since we were kids watching Stone Cold Steve Austin give us bumper stickers to put on our Jeeps and our trucks, you know, 316, John 316, and football players, you know, putting it on their painting it on their bodies. I mean, this verse is probably the most famous verse in all of Scripture. I was reminded during the Sunday school class this morning that Luther called this, you know, kind of the gospel summed up or in brief. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. We probably know this and can just recite it and breathe it. So I wonder if there is some things about the way we've been reading this verse over and over again, not only in the church but in popular culture, that kind of like Timmy, we see the thrust, but maybe we've been kind of seeing a different meaning through it, a different reason for there to be this person following us. So what I want to do is invite us into a kind of an open and questioning mode about what this verse tells us. For God so loved the world. For God so loved the world. So for God so loved the world that God gave his only Son. Can I ask, what in the world is God doing coming amongst us to save us? What is going on there? I think as we read this passage, for a long time we've understood, particularly in the Protestant church in the West, that God came to send us his Son to save us from our sins so that we would be, in a sense, right with God. And that's how I think most of us have read this. God sends Jesus, and Jesus dies on the cross for the sake of our sins so that we are forgiven, so that after we die, we'll be good with God. And that certainly is a good reading, and it's a reading that's been throughout the life of the church. But I wonder if we go back to Scripture and engage a couple of stories, we might kind of tear open or break through some of the sense of what might have led us to that and how we might see a new meaning through John's telling of this verse. In order to do that, we have to go back to Genesis chapter 22. And we have to see that in Genesis chapter 22, you will find God asking Abraham, and Abraham being prepared to sacrifice his own son, Isaac, as he walks together with him up the mountain. And that paints a picture of God, doesn't it? It sort of paints a picture of this idea of a God who demands sacrifice of humanity, or demands a human sacrifice, this idea that God is asking us to give up everything. And for Abraham, this would be like God asking him to sacrifice his entire identity. Because in that time, your legacy, your life, only lived on through your children, and in particular in that time, through your son. And so if you had to sacrifice your son, then your name would be no more. You would sacrifice yourself off of the face of the earth. And so in that sense, Abraham had to be willing to give up everything. So this image, this idea of God asking for a human sacrifice. But God doesn't follow through with that. God asks us to be prepared for that, but God then doesn't do that. God provides a substitute, right? This, what we come to know as the scapegoat. And so Abraham goes and sacrifices that, and we continue on with the story, Isaac, who beget Jacob, and we have the whole people chosen and called by God. Okay, so that's one image of God we have. Flip over, and we come to our New Testament. The Lenten season, we're preparing for the passion of our Lord. And what we see is precisely the opposite. Now it is humanity that is asking for a sacrifice. It's humanity that is asking for blood. And as though we think like that might be a strange thought for us, you have to remember that again and again, God came to the people, again and again, calling them to be faithful, giving them Torah, giving them life, giving them the prophetic times, the judges. I mean, so many times, God coming to the people, asking for them to be faithful, the people being faithful for a while, and then thinking that they've found a better way, that they've got it all figured out, realizing the failing of that, and then the cycle begins over and over again. And so we have then, in the time of the New Testament time around Jesus, we have here again, predictably, a life of love and mercy, a blameless life in Jesus coming to us, God himself in human form coming to us. And we still, as a humanity, we can't deal with it. We think we've got it figured out in our own way. We think we've got it figured out. And we demand sacrifice. It's such a different image, right? From a God who demands sacrifice and provides a substitute to humanity who sacrifices none other than the very presence of God himself. This kind of leads me to wonder if, as we think about Jesus coming, as we think about this not first time God has come among us, God walked among us in the Garden of Eden, we know, and kept coming to his people in different forms throughout salvation history. If it's not in the fullness of time that God comes to us finally as God's own very self, God in flesh, God sending his Son not to change God's mind about humanity, but to change our mind about God, to change our heart and mind and faith of the God that we believe in. Not a God as we hear in the prophets, Hosea, I desire not sacrifice, but mercy. And so what we see then is God loves us not because we are good, but God loves us because God is good. God loves us because God is good. We don't earn, we don't merit, we don't work our way into the love of God. We are loved by God. So if God comes in this way to love us and to change our minds, then what is God asking us to change in our minds? And that is, as we go to the cross, we see Jesus willingly offer his own life in his passion to this need of ours to have sacrifice, to solve it, to fix it in our own way through a sacrificial system. And in undergoing that, not only in his death, but then on the third day, rising up to life, he exposes the futility of the sacrificial system. He asks us to consider that God does not need our sacrifices of one another in order to be satisfied, in order to be happy, in order to forgive us and love us. That's what God did in Jesus Christ's whole life and ministry. The way that he was with people, forgiving them, loving them, healing them. Not asking them if they had repented, not asking them if they had checked off the box of their certain ritual requirement, but simply asking them in their present moment to be present back to him. So it seems that we still struggle in this time. John does this beautifully, I think. He talks about the people who continue to live in darkness, and then those who live in the light. And the light is the light of resurrection. The light is the light that death is not the final answer, that small deaths that we experience in our life now are not the final answer. And that as we, as human beings, continue to think we have it all figured out and continue to see the disastrous results of that in our societies and in our cities, invites us into light. invites us to consider that we need no longer and never have needed to sacrifice anyone else for the sake of God's forgiveness and mercy and love. That the only thing we need to sacrifice in ourselves is the idea that we will advance in God's eyes, that we will be better and more holy if we just sacrifice those who are broken, those who are sinful. But as Jesus said, let those who are without sin go ahead and cast the first stone. So we have in our time and in our life a continuing challenge of systems that lie in darkness. Not just individual acts, but whole sectors of society in our world, in our town, in our community, that are still in darkness. Towns like ours that came through a time of civil rights, rough for the wear. In our world today, in Burma, there are approximately 700,000 ethnic Muslims who are being driven out in some sort of genocidal tendency of the government there. In Syria, we have a challenge to work out a ceasefire long enough to be able to deliver basic humanitarian aid to those who are trapped and who are suffering there. In our own time, in our own community, you can name more of these systems that are rampant, that are sacrificing people and lives, sacrificing our very brothers and sisters as we go throughout our lives. And Christ is coming into us asking, has our mind, has our heart been changed? Or are we still thinking that we have it figured out and enacting in the way we organize ourselves in the world by systems that perpetuate sacrifice? That's a hard topic. So far, I'm just trying to tell you like the world is, and I'm sorry. As Christians, we come into this place not from a posture of darkness, from a posture of light. So once you've seen the light, you can't hide it. You can't put it under a bushel basket, but you gotta let it shine. And often we think about letting it shine with this verse in John 3:16 is, whosoever believeth in me shall have everlasting life. And so we think about with our minds whether we believe these things, whether these things can even be true. We give assent in our minds to these statements of faith. So, belief, then, we have to ask what that means for us. This Greek word really means, in that time, belief is not just a matter of the mind, but it's a matter of the heart. To say that I believe might better be substituted in English by saying that I trust in. Because trust connotes relationship. And so in order to experience the light and to spread the light in the midst of this, in order to be healed of our need incessantly, it seems, both in ourselves and in the world, to continue to perpetuate our needs as more important than others, our lives as more important than others, our way as more important than others, to the extent that we sacrifice their freedom, their hope, their joy, and even sometimes their life, we must, I think, live as Christians in the life and pattern that Jesus lived. The cure for this is not simply saying that we believe so that when we die we will experience eternal life, but rather so that we will trust, so that the life we experience now is one impacted and changed by God's passion in His Son Jesus and in the resurrection. So, bring it home for me, Nick. How do I do this? One way we do this is by doing precisely what we're doing here, which is gathering together as the body of Christ in proximity to the things that He asked us to do, the things that He gave us to do. One of those things is to gather together to share and remember His presence with us, nourished by His grace in the meal of grace. To gather together to put this food that is nourishment for our spiritual lives into our bodies, to be generated into the world for this love and mercy, which was His mission in His life. But it continues to be in proximity to Jesus that we live beyond these walls. Continues to be in proximity and trust and intimacy with our God that we see the struggles of our world and we respond with compassion. We see those who are in need of healing and we don't ask them if they have taken a belief test. We instead invite them into that trust by showing them our trust and by healing them and making them whole. We've been given power through God's Spirit, God's presence with us, to live our life in this way, to see and bring light in places where it seems like there is nothing but darkness, and to have great hope for the life following Christ. And that can show up anywhere. So if you're walking around this week, if you're on your way to go somewhere, and you keep looking over your shoulder, and you keep thinking you see somebody kind of following you, whether they got a toddler daughter or not, turn around. Go see who this Shirley Goodnest is and her daughter Mercy. And breathe light to whatever darkness might be in her life. For that light cannot be extinguished. That light cannot be put out. And once you've shared the light, you've got more light. You never run out. Thanks be to God.